with Matthew chapter 6, from verse 19 to 21. Matthew chapter 6, verse 19 to 21. Destroy. And where thieves breaking and steal. And wear up yourself, precious and devil. Where neither moth nor rust destroys. And where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Here the scripture is saying that the direction of our treasure is the direction of our heart. The direction of our investment is the direction of our heart. If your treasure is there, your heart is there. So, if your money is there, your heart is there. If your skill is there, your heart is there. If your talent is there, your heart is there. So basically, Jesus is establishing the fact that where you put your treasure is where your influence is. And he's trying to say that there are places that human beings try to save their treasures. But in those places on the heart, they are under the threat of thieves, of destroyers. One of my friends, just last week, they traveled to France, the wife, the husband, the children. But before they arrived, some people broke into their homes, took all the jewelries, took everything. Right? So that means that the things that we actually try to keep, they are subject to the threat of the thieves. And Jesus was mentioning the fact that there is another place where you can actually keep your treasure, and that is in heaven. And in this place, it is more secure. It cannot be stolen by thieves. They can't break in and steal it. And then it cannot be destroyed by either rust or moth. So, anytime you sow into the kingdom, anytime you partner with a ministry like this, you must know that you are putting your treasure in a secure place. And also it's an indication of where your heart is. Praise God. So having laid that foundation, I want us to look at the word of David to his soldiers when they recover Hall from the Amalekites. You remember in 1 Samuel chapter 30, the Bible says that when David and his men were not around, the Amalekites, they invaded Ziklag and they took everything away. And then when David came with his soldiers, everyone was downcast. Everyone was in distress because their wives were taken, their children were taken, their properties were taken. And they wept. The weeping did not do anything. Natural by the thought of stoning David. David also wept until there was no strength within him. And then eventually he encouraged himself in the Lord and went to ask, shall I pursue? Shall I overtake? Shall I recover? And God said, you can go ahead and you will recover. The core of ministry work is a work of recovery. Work of building people. And particularly in the ministry like this where training, discipleship is the center of the activity. No man can fulfill destiny unless his proper unless first of all is recovered from the power of sin and Satan. And then unless he's now built up to become a strong disciple. In order to disciple others, And in order to be able to withstand the assault of the enemy on his destiny. So basically, every ministry is engaged in the work of restoration, in the work of recovery, in the work of building people. And this ministry is not left out of that activity. So if a ministry is engaged in this work, there will be people at the forefront. There will be people that will have to take care of some other things. So in 1 Samuel chapter 30, from verse 17, the Bible says, "Then David attacked them from twilight until the evening of the next day." That was when he had come to where those people that invaded Ziklag were. Not a man of them escaped, except 400 young men who rode on camels and fled. So David recovered all that the Amalekites had carried away. And David rescued his two wives, and nothing of theirs was lacking, either small or great, sons or daughters, spoil or anything which they had taken from them. David recovered all. So according to the word of the Lord, everything was recovered. Mm-hmm. Praise God. Mm-hmm. Then David took all the flocks and herds they had driven before those of their livestock, and said, "This is David's spoil." Now David came to the 200 men who had been so weary that they could not follow David, whom they also had made to stay at the professor. So they went out to meet David and to meet the people who were with him. And when David came near the people, he greeted them. Then all the wicked and worthless men of those who went with David answered and said, "Because they did not go with us, we will not give them any of the spoil that we have recovered, except for every man's wife and children, that they may lead them away and depart." But David said, "My brethren, you shall not do so. With what the Lord has given us, who has preserved us and delivered into our hands the troop that came against us, for who will heed you in this matter? But as his path is, who goes down to the battle, so shall his path be, who stay by the supplies. They shall share alike." The person that is on the field preaching, and the person that is making sure that there is supply for them, they will share the profit of the ministry alike. So, if you are engaged in a ministry like Clockhouse Ministries, with your skill, with your talent, with your treasures, God is saying that even the leader of the ministry, the ones, those that goes into the villages, those that goes into the field, the reward to them and the reward to you will be the same. When I started ministry, I was a manager in an international company, and then the call came strongly on me. So I decided to leave. And in those days, I still used some of those offices to do my corresponding, because I've not had my personal office. So I would still go to back there, use their email, use their phone to make some communication. So one of those days, I came in. And then as I came in, one of my friends, who is a colleague, just came and said, "Pastor, you know, God is leading me to be supporting your business." That was the first major support that I had in the work. Up till now, he's still supporting. In fact, last night, he still sent money to our account. And that was it. He started. And then 3 months later, he told me that he had desire for a better car. One thing that is very, very important is this. When you are careful, when you show commitment to a vision that God has established, He will bless you. So he told me that he desired this car, but it means will not be able to handle it. I said, well, it's time for you also to receive a financial miracle. Paul says that though we are poor, then we make many rich. We have the authority to do that because you are committed to the call of God upon my life. You are committed to the grace of God upon my life. I pray a simple prayer for you. What happened was that he was supernaturally promoted and he was given some money, so he got the car.
Amen.
Then after a year, he said to me that, I want to go to the U.S. I want to further my study and I want to seek for a better opportunity. I prayed. And you know what? A door got open for him. He got a scholarship. And he went to the U.S. Him, his wife, and his family. He studied for his master's degree and completed his master's degree. So, but it was very long. It was very rough. You know, when you are a student in the U.S., you are restricted. You can't walk. He was in level manager in Kuntala Ngambu, but he had to be distributing papers able to survive early in the morning in the U.S. And then I remember that he was only able to support us maybe one or two times, even in that struggle. And then after he completed, he said to me, he called me one day, he said, I want to come back home. I spoke in the flesh, I said, no, stay in the U.S., but I will pray about it. Then I went to pray, and God spoke to me and said, let him come, I will make room for him. Then I called him and said, look, you can come back to the U.S. Everybody come back to Nigeria. Everybody discouraged him. And because someone is related to Obasanjo and Obasanjo was independent. And some people are saying, is it because you are related to Obasanjo? He said, no, it's not about that. Then he came down, and first month there was no job. Second month, there was none. And then the third month, the friend in Port Harcourt sent for me, said, there was trouble, come and help. This and that, I've been attacked, this and that. So I traveled by bus to Port Harcourt. And then suddenly I wanted to pray. Then I dozed off a bit. Then I saw a revelation. I saw him got a job. I called him immediately. I said, within the next 3 weeks, you are getting a job. And so he got a job. Started with that one. What's the name of this company? Management consultant company. And then there was this MVC that came up with an advertisement for a plant manager. And then he applied. They invited him for the interview. And he went for the interview. They asked him certain questions. He answered. When he came out of the interview, he called one of my bosses in those days and said, when he asked this question, this was the answer that I gave. That was it, the answer you gave is wrong. So he called me and said, Pastor, when they asked me this question, because me too, I study chemical engineering, but by the grace again, I have a doctorate degree in chemical engineering and I do research in chemical. He called me and said, Pastor, this was the answer I gave. I knew the answer was wrong. But if I said it was wrong, then it would be wrong. Mm. You don't get it. But if I said it was right, it would be right. Is somebody getting that mystery?
Yeah,
I said, that is the correct answer. You got it right. And you are getting the job. So they called him and said, you got the job. And then I said, you don't have enough experience, so we'll put you as the logistic manager or the plant manager. Then we'll watch you and then give you the post. You get someone appointed letter by the plant manager, but you are saying that he will be a lesser manager. I said, don't worry, you accept it. You know what happened? He went to Port Harcourt as the logistic manager. And because he would not steal,
just because he was so kind with money. And the people that were behind him had been stealing. He was able to save maybe 200 million or something.
Wow.
Within 3 months.
Wow.
So instead of giving him the position of plant manager, he was promoted to regional manager.
Wow.
Within 6 months.
Wow.
The long and short of the story is that he today is a director in one of the biggest companies in Nigeria, is still committed to us. Till today. As he was getting committed, God was promoting him. God was enlarging him. Today he's so familiar in the US. And then he is so in Nigeria, you know. Most of my friends are doing that now. I don't know. They feel comfortable to have their family in the US. But what I'm trying to say is this. If you have identified a ministry like this ministry, and you get committed to the ministry with your skills, with your talent, with your money, the first benefit is this: God increases you in the ministry.
Mm-hmm.